I'm Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Exercise your imagination. This week, Adam Hall's chess match of continental intrigue. Queen in Danger. Starring Juliette Mills. Robert Brown. And Murray Matheson. In Elliot Lewis's production of The Zero Hour.
The Mutual Broadcasting System presents The Zero Hour. Sponsored in part by
Metropolitan Life Insurance and Big Red Chewing Tobacco. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
London's Hugo Bishop, eccentric connoisseur of crime, would be the first to admit that he is not infallible. However, he'd be quick to add that he is seldom wrong, and he is now preparing to administer the acid test for a course in murder. Who was the real killer at Ludgate Hill? The obvious answer is Mervyn Spate. The man was convicted. But Hugo Bishop hasn't time for the obvious, nor has Thalma Tasman. Nor, for that matter, has Mervyn Spate. With Scotland Yard's dragnet closing in, his time is running out. Hugo Bishop's test has but one question. It's multiple choice. The real murderer is A, Victor Tasman, Thelma's common-law husband. B, Maurice Gerald, her friend and employer. Or C, Rex Willison, fashion photographer and willing companion. Everyone ready? Pencil sharpened. The conclusion of Queen in Danger. After the word go.
I was certain that it was Mervyn come at last, and he had come to kill me. I pointed the gun and squeezed the trigger. It kicked in my hand. I was holding it so tightly, I don't know how many times I fired. But the dark shadow of the man didn't crumple to the floor in a pool of blood as I expected. Instead, it moved into the room and came toward me. And I saw that it wasn't Mervyn at all. It was Rex Willison.
It's all right, love. You missed.
He reached out for the gun, and I dropped it limply into his hand. He eased me into a chair, and I saw him drop the weapon into his pocket as a policeman came to the door, followed by a couple of my more curious neighbors.
Aye, what's up, mister? What were their shots all about?
Shots? I didn't hear any shots.
Oh, come off it, mister. We heard them plain enough, didn't we, Herbert? Three of them. Bam, bam, bam. Not that. Right, Herbert?
Oh, that wasn't shooting. The ice tray was jammed in the fridge. I was breaking it free with a hammer. Yes, you'll have to charge me with a breach of the peace, officer.
Glad to know that's all it was. All right, people. Let's all get back to our own flats, shall we?
Sorry, officer. Didn't know I was waking the dead.
People are too curious for their own good sometimes.
Well, it's good to know you boys are on the job.
Ah, we're on a bloody job, all right. Extra hours these days. Well, good night, then.
Good night, officer. He's gone. Luckily, he didn't see the slugs in the doorpost. You're a rotten shot, love.
Oh, Rex, I'm sorry.
I know what you thought. You thought I was he. You've had the heebies ever since he broke out.
Then you know who I am.
I've known it all along. I covered the Joanna Martin murder for one of the newspaper syndicates.
And you haven't told anyone? About me, I mean.
Oh, you know me, love. I'm not much of a talker.
Oh, Rex.
But I must say, I don't think the gun is a good idea.
May I have it back?
If you don't mind, I think I'd better keep it for you.
Mervyn Spate sat rigidly at my side as I guided my ancient Rolls-Royce directly through the heart of the police dragnet.
Hang on. It'll soon be roses the rest of the way. Everybody I see looks like a cop.
They jolly well could be. Oh. That one is for sure. An old friend of mine from the yard. A bit gullible, I must say. He spotted my car. You stay put. I'll handle him. Good evening, Freddy. You look a bit fat.
This isn't exactly fun and games, Hugo. You have anything for me?
Yes, old boy. I've got Spate in my car. Did you want him?
Correction, this is fun and games to you, I suppose.
As a matter of fact, I'm thinking of throwing a party later tonight. An informal little spree at the Rothbury Club.
Enjoy yourself.
Look in about midnight. You might find it interesting.
Not as interesting as I expect to find my bed at that hour.
You can come officially, Freddy. Bring all the boys. Drinks on me. Spate will be there.
Hugo, are you on the level?
You know me, chump. Now I must be going. I have someone with me. See you about 12. Spate and I made it the rest of the way through the police blockade without a hitch. 3 minutes after, we were safely in my digs. Spate was sound asleep. Gory reported to me that she had managed to contact everyone I'd asked her to, making up the most interesting guest list any party ever had going for it. While we waited, I tried to engage Gory in our continuing chess match. But as usual, she couldn't keep her mind on the game.
There is the chance that nothing will come off at this party, isn't there?
Perhaps. But I believe our person, the man in Spate's sketches, is among those on the guest list. And if he shows, and I believe he will, our party is bound to be a smashing success. A reunion, I should think. Our person hasn't seen Mervyn Spate since that fateful night at Ludgate Hill.
Do I understand you to say, Hugo, that Spate will be attending the party?
You understand me perfectly, Gory girl. Mervyn Spate is to be the guest of honor. I went into the next room to rouse Spate. Wasn't easy. He'd gotten only an hour's rest, and I knew he needed more. But it couldn't be helped. It was now or never. A cold shower, a shave, black coffee, and a set of clean clothes brought him round. He was standing before the mirror, looping his tie into a full Windsor. His eyes were bloodshot from fatigue, but they were wide open, brimming with anticipation. Are you ready for this, Spate?
I've been ready for a long time.
Now, don't blow your cool, chap. If you see him, don't do anything. Leave that to me.
I don't know. After 2 long years where I've been...
Now, just promise me you won't do anything rash.
Mr. Bishop, I appreciate all you've done for me, but I must tell you one thing. I am a man of my word. And if I see that face tonight, the evil face that burned into my memory, I cannot promise you anything.
Through the dark London streets. It was a rough night for the boys. All over town there were splits, butties, dicks, bogies, flatties, the hot lot and the heavy mob. You couldn't put your mug outside the door without getting a flash lamp on it. Even the river was hot. But in the ballrooms, the nightclubs and late supper establishments, no one was worried by the police hunt that spread like a net over the city. They danced, ate, drank, and were merry. In the Rothbury Club, there were perhaps 50 people jammed between the snack counter, the two bars, and the tiny bandstand. The word had got round. Hugo Bishop was giving a party. No one knew why I was giving a party, but that wasn't important. It was a good party, and these days, good parties were hard to come by. In a way, it was a surprise party, and I adore surprises. I squeezed through the crowd to one of the bars.
Hello, Mr. Bishop. Bloody good party. You know, I've never been to one like this.
Good of you to come, Mrs. Moss.
I never tasted gin like this before, neither.
No, I don't imagine you ever have. Sip it slowly. I don't want you to miss anything. I looked around the room. Thelma Tasman was just arriving. She was accompanied by her employer, Maurice Gerald. They were both impeccably dressed and made a rather handsome couple. The Queen looked majestic as always. The White Knight, number one. I wondered, could Maurice Gerald be the man in the sketches? Spate would know, and so would I in due time. But there were others to consider. Rex Willison, for one. I spotted him in the crowd. He's not an easy man to miss, broad shoulders and all. He was conversing with a pretty lass I knew to be Thelma Tasman's best friend, Eve Jordan. Rex saved me the trouble of wading through the mob.
Oh, it looks like quite a blowout, Bishop. What's the occasion?
Shouldn't need a reason for a party, should we?
No, but something tells me you have one. When are you coming by to see those photographs?
You mean your syndicated coverage of the Joanna Martin murder?
You expressed an interest in seeing them, remember?
Yes, yes. Old news never dies, does it? I'll see those photographs, Willison. But for now, I suggest you relax and enjoy yourself. White Knight number 2. Present and accounted for. One more to go. The lady's husband, Victor Tasman. In the meantime, at a small table in the corner of the room, a man sat with a drink in front of him. He just sat there, fiddling with his tie and looking at the people. The lighting around him was dim. He was almost in shadow. No one paid him any notice. At straight up midnight, Detective Inspector Freddy Frisnay walked in and sent his plainclothes cronies to mingle among the crowd. Gullible but prompt. That's Freddy. I led him straight to the small table in the dark corner. I think it's about time you two gentlemen met.
Hello, Spade. We've been looking all over for you.
I know.
Come along, Freddy. I'll get you that drink. That's Snipe.
That's him, all right. I'll be damned if I know how you did it.
Even a hunted man couldn't resist one of Hugo Bishop's parties.
You can't just leave him here, you know.
You can have your man at a price, Freddy. My price.
All right, let's hear it.
A couple of hours to the outside.
You're sure of what you're doing?
Spate's here, isn't he? And you have the place covered?
All right, Hugo. You brought us this far, I have to give you that. We'll go along for a bit.
I have something else for you, too.
Some of Spate's sketches. You think this man could be here at the party, too, now?
Bucket of beer to a triple thick shake says he is. I looked over at Thelma Tasman and was certain he had to be. The Queen's white knights were swarming round her, including a late arrival that I surmised was, at last, Victor Tasman.
Darling, are you sure you're all right?
Yes, Victor. I feel much better now that you're here.
I tried to come up earlier on the afternoon train, planning to go back on Monday. But business got frantic and I had to hang on. Then I had a phone call from a Miss Gorringe about this party. I don't quite understand. But she said you would be here and that it was important that I come.
According to Mrs. Bishop, it is. But I don't know any more about it than you do.
That's the secret of a successful party. Keep your guests in suspense.
Oh, Mr. Bishop, this is Victor Tasman.
How do you do? Strong handshake, I like that. Glad you could make it, Mr. Tasman.
I found your Miss Gorringe rather difficult to refuse.
Yes, I find her that way myself. Thelma, may I tear you away for a moment?
Victor, would you mind?
Of course not, dear.
Thelma, there is something you should know. Mervyn Spade is here.
Mervyn?
It's quite all right. He won't bother you. In fact, I rather think he's enjoying the party. I just didn't want you to be startled into doing something rash if you saw him.
But what if he...
Good girl. Enjoy the party. So the board was set. All the pieces were in place. Victor Tasman, the final piece, had taken his place alongside the Queen. Freddy and his men were at the ready. I waited, keeping my eyes on the man sitting alone in the darkest corner of the room. One last preliminary, and then we could begin. I scanned the room, looking for one particular woman. Suddenly, I saw Rex Willison make a bolt to the door. Not going, Willison?
No, I have to make a phone call.
I wouldn't if I were.
It's urgent.
I expect so, but you'll have to wait.
Look, I know Spate's here. I've seen him.
So have the police, and they're here, too, all over the place. We're all sitting on a tidy powder keg. You're going off half-cocked with Philadelphia prematurely.
But it's a big story. I can't ignore it.
There's likely to be even a bigger one. You'll have an exclusive. Just hold on.
For how long?
Not long, no, I shouldn't think. I spotted the woman I was looking for over where I'd seen her earlier at the bar.
Ah, Mrs. Martin, having a good time?
Oh, ripping.
I'd like you to meet a friend of mine. You may know him.
Me? Know someone here?
Yes, I'm sure of it. Someone. My friend may not be that one. Shall we find out? She was a bit tipsy, but managed to take my arm. I led her over to where Mervyn Spate was seated.
Well, where is he?
Ever see this man before, Mrs. Martin? Did he ever come round looking for Joanna before she was murdered?
I've never seen this bloke before in my life.
Mrs. Martin's denial of ever having seen Mervyn Spate completed the preliminaries. Now it was time to proceed. God save the Queen. I suggested to Spate that he take a walk round the room with me. Out of the corner of my eye, I saw Gory watching us with interest, and Freddy Frisnay keeping tabs on our every move. Spate's face remained expressionless as he made the rounds. Well, you've already met one of Scotland Yard's finest, and of course, my right-hand woman, Vera Gorringe. The young lady traveling behind us is Joanna Martin's sister-in-law. Ah, Mrs. Martin, forgive the oversight on my part. This gentleman is Mervyn Spate.
Oh, he ain't the one that was hanging round.
Correct, my dear.
Then he ain't the one who did in the winch.
Correct again.
Then who did?
Come along. We're sure to find out shortly. Lord and Lady Cummins, so very good to see you again. I'd like you to meet Mervyn Spate. One of London's premier oral surgeons, Dr. Westbourne. Dr. Mervyn Spate. Some of high society's most reputable people are here tonight, including the lovely lady seated right over here. Known throughout the fashion world as Gloria Del Rey, the three gentlemen seated beside her are Rex Willison, Maurice Gerald, and the lady's husband, I believe, Victor Tasman.
What is the meaning of this?
You shall see, Mr. Tasman.
I resent this public display.
Do you now, Mr. Gerald?
That man is Mervyn Spate.
Quiet, Mr. Willison.
And he's got a gun.
Fetch him. He's the one.
Spate, don't do it.
Well, Mr. Gerald, he seems to be pointing the gun at you.
He's the one she called the gent.
We'll see to him for you, Spate. Please, put down that gun.
I've drawn your picture over and over. Now I see you again after 2 long years.
Spate, nobody move. This is my party and this is my guest. Now, Mr. Spate, let me remind you about the trees. Remember, you couldn't see beyond them at the asylum.
He's crazy. Somebody stop him.
He has a point there, Mervyn. You are behaving like a crazy man. I suggest that you hand me the gun.
I told you, Bishop, no promises.
Well, then, you leave me no choice. I'll have to protect the real killer.
Hugo, don't!
Stand aside, Bishop!
No promises, mate.
Stand aside.
Shoot now, and they'll put you away where you won't ever see the trees. Now, what's it going to be? Spade. Very sane decision.
No. Thank you, Mr. Bishop.
Don't thank me. Thank Mervyn Spate for sparing you. A second time. The next morning, Gory and I sat around my desk and listened to Maurice Gerald's taped confession. Freddie had sent it over.
It was 3 or 4 years ago. After an all-night party, I got involved with her, and then she started taking me for money. She made more and more demands. I could see there was to be no end to it. There was my wife and the kids. Now, why should a woman like that be allowed to destroy a marriage? I mean, a man's whole life.
So you killed her?
Yes. Yes. I killed her.
Well done, Hugo.
Yes, it was, wasn't it?
The Queen is out of danger.
For the time being, at least. I trust she'll marry Victor Tasman now.
And Mervyn Spate is free at last.
Yes. Free to create a forest full of trees.
Bloody good show.
And they owe it all to you, gory girl.
Rubbish.
Modesty, Lady Verisham. Pure modesty. Shall we continue our game now? I'll clear away this mess. Where were we? I believe it's your mood.
Mr. Bishop, you're certain to give me a sound thrashing. I'm a ruddy fool to ever play chess with you. That's curious.
Well, what is it you find so bloody curious, Gory Girl?
Check. Mate.
Good show. Bloody good show.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
That concludes this week's production of The Zero Hour. Adam Hall's Queen in Danger. Next week, we'll begin another exciting dramatization of a tale of mystery and suspense. We'll tell our story in 5 days, at the same time Monday through Friday. So on Monday, rest your eyes and listen here to The Zero Hour.
This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
Been listening to The Zero Hour, a presentation of the Mutual Broadcasting System in association with Hollywood Radio Theater, heard every weekday at this time. Rod Serling is your host. Zero Hour is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis. The Hollywood Radio Theater theme was played by Ferranti and Teicher and is now available on United Artists Records and Tapes. Hugh Douglas speaking. Tune in Monday. And once again,
rest your eyes and listen here
to The Zero Hour.
This is Mutual, your news and sports radio network.